Chapter 9. The Lunar Period. The dawn of the lunar period began after the passing of the solar period's cosmic night. Then the solar universe condensed itself into ethereal matter and life recapitulated all of the states of the past cosmic periods. The beginning of our ethereal Earth, which is called the Earth-Moon, the lunar period in all of its plenitude, was initiated after those processes of recapitulation. The human beings of the lunar epoch were short in stature, and their bodies were of ethereal matter. They built their houses underground, even though they were placing roofs on their homes that were similar to those which we place on our present houses. They negotiated, worked, and were enjoying themselves the same way as we do. Their urban populations were small and were connected as our own towns are, by avenues and roads. They also had automobiles similar to our cars. Their mountains were transparent like crystal and were of a very beautiful dark blue, which is like the blue color seen when looking at the mountains from a far-off distance, which is the ether. The whole of our ancient Earth was of that beautiful color. Volcanoes were in incessant eruption, and there was more water than in our present epoch. Immense lakes and vast seas were existing everywhere. In this lunar period, we see Beelzebub living in an enormous house, which was constructed beneath the ground. Here, within a large room, he was instructing his disciples. He was wearing a tunic of black and red stripes, a turban and a cape of the same color. He was a black magician who had a tall and robust body. All of his black chelas, disciples, were profoundly venerating him. Beelzebub had two books, one book which he was reading to his disciples in order to instruct them, and the other that only he was studying in secrecy. There were a lot of proselytes among the human beings of the lunar period, which he conquered for black magic. The flora and fauna of that time was very different to our own. Here we clairvoyantly see plant minerals, that is to say, semi-plants, semi-minerals, semi-animal plants, etc. In other words, the three kingdoms of nature were not completely defined as in the present time, since in that epoch one kingdom was integrated with the other. Among the trees there was the marked tendency for the branches and leaves to make a concave shape, which caused them to resemble gigantic umbrellas. Through all existent things, this marked tendency of inclining downwards was nature's living scripture foreseen everywhere. Its process downwards was towards the condensation of our present physical earth. Nature is a living scripture everywhere, therefore, its designs are written based on this living scripture. On the other hand, we see in our present epoch, in this century, a marked tendency of the human being to build very high buildings and airplanes each time more and more rapid, etc. The branches of our actual trees do not want to incline downwards, instead they want to elevate themselves upwards to the sun. This is because our earth has already reached its maximum material condensation, and now it yearns to elevate itself anew, to etherealize itself again. Really, the ether is inundating the air and etherealizing the earth each time more and more. Thus, at the end of the great Aryan root race, the ether will be totally visible in the air. Then, all the creatures who live in the ether will share all of their activities with the human being. During the lunar period, the physical bodies of our present humanity reached a high degree in their perfection. We acquired the astral body during that period. We, the human beings of present times, were the animals of the lunar period. The angels and demons of ancient periods were floating in the ethereal atmosphere of our Earth Moon. They were visible and tangible to the whole of that humanity. Those human beings perceived the archangels, archangeloi, or creatures of fire behind the erupted fire of volcanoes, and the lords of formation behind all of the existent forms. The children of life were regulating the vital functions of every existent thing, and the elemental creatures of the five elements of nature were coexisting with the human beings. The lords of wisdom were the ones who endowed us with the astral body. The lords of the personality were the ones who endowed us with personality, which at this present time is looked upon with much despise by the theosophists. The intimates, monad spirits, of this present humanity acquired the body of the human spirit, called the body of willpower, which Krishnamurti despises so much. Willpower is the power with which we can dominate our passions in order to convert ourselves into gods. When the law of the Gnostic alchemist is accomplished, the introduction of the virile member into the feminine vagina and its withdrawal without spilling the semen, then, the fire of passion is transmuted into astral light. This is how the astral body is strengthened and is filled with resplendent light. Therefore, all of the resplendent fruits of this marvelous astral organism are plunged within the body of willpower, which beautifies it. The fire of chastity is the fire of the Holy Spirit, and the body of the Holy Spirit is the body of willpower, also called abstract mind and causal body. Really, the body of the abstract mind is converted into the fire of Pentecost when inundated with fire by means of sexual magic. It utters ineffable things in all the languages of the world within the speechless human who is inebriated with the Holy Spirit. It is what the Holy Gnostic Bible textually states, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave them utterance. The Acts of the Apostles 2:1-6, Jehovah, the Holy Spirit, guards the body of the Holy Spirit in ourselves. Jehovah was the highest initiate from the lunar epoch. Humanity was divided into angels and Lucifers when that great period ended, since many are called, but few are chosen. Max Heindel and Rudolf Steiner affirm in their books that all of humanity will be saved. This is due to the ignorance of these authors. Verses 23, 24, 25, 26, 27 and 28 of the 13th chapter of Luke textually say, "Then said one unto him, Lord, are there few that be saved? And he said unto them, Strive to enter in at the strait gate, for many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in, and shall not be able. When once the master of the house is risen up, and hath shut to the door, and ye be gin to stand without, and to knock at the door, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us, and he shall answer and say unto you, I know you not whence ye are, then ye shall begin to say, We have eaten and drunk in thy presence, and thou hast taught in our streets. But he shall say, I tell you, I know you not whence ye are, depart from me, all ye workers of iniquity. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth, when ye shall see Abraham, and Isaac, and Jacob, and all of the prophets, in the kingdom of God, and you yourselves thrust out. When the cosmic night of the lunar period arrived, Jehovah and his angels, Lucifer and his demons, withdrew themselves from the cosmic scenario. Thus, the whole of nature entered into a profound repose. Chapter 10 The terrestrial period. When the cosmic night of the lunar period had passed, then the universe became condensed into a nebula, which is referred to by Laplace. It was the beginning of this physical-chemical epoch in which we presently live in. Nature recapitulated all of the former cosmic periods, which are allegorically described in Genesis. In the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. Genesis 1 verses 1-2, these were the times of Laplace's nebula, during which the earth recapitulated the Saturn epoch. And God said, Let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. Genesis 1, 3-4, then, the molecules of the dark heat nebula entered into friction under the powerful impulse of the lost word of the Creator, and this nebula ignited and became luminous. This was the Hyperborean epoch during which the solar atoms from the solar epoch entered into activity. Our Earth was an igneous globe filled with the wisdom of the fire and filled with the light that the same fire produces. Thus, the archangels, who were the human beings of the solar epoch, were the beings who lived within this fiery globe. They expressed themselves with all of the plenitude of their wisdom. And God said, "Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters." And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven. And the evening and the morning were the second day. Genesis 1:5-8. Here the Bible keeps referring to the recapitulation of the solar period. Moisture was generated by the contact of this igneous globe with the surrounding interplanetary regions, which are cold. Enormous clouds were condensed, which were gravitating back to the source of heat in the form of rain, and enormous seas and wells were formed, which were incessantly boiling upon the fiery globe. Thus, the clouds separated the waters of heaven from the waters of the fiery globe, and God said, "Let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear," and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas, and God saw that it was good. Genesis 1:9-10. The incessant boiling of the water wells surrounding the fiery core finally caused incrustation, and the dry land appeared upon the surface of the fiery globe. Thus, the word of the Creator was accomplished when he said, "And let the dry land appear," and God called the dry land earth. This is how the first terrestrial crust called Lemuria was formed. During this Lemurian epoch, the Earth recapitulated the lunar period, because the following law in life exists. Before initiating its new manifestations, nature has to recapitulate all of its former manifestations. Therefore, whosoever wants to objectively know all of the evolving processes of humanity has to observe the human fetus from its very conception. Within the maternal womb, the human fetus recapitulates the whole metamorphosis of the human body from its very ancient origins. The human body is nothing else but the scale of our igneous serpent. Thus, the solar universe is only the scale of the serpent of the solar logos of this solar system. When the serpent abandons the scale is disintegrated. This igneous serpent is the Kundalini, referred to in the chapter entitled The Staff of the Patriarchs. The mountain of Juratina. There exists in Colombia a very high mountain named the Juratina. This mountain is situated in the Vasquez territory, state of Bocaya. It is at the shore of the broad and profound waters of a river named Minero. The peasants say that the mountain is enchanted. They tell the most ancient traditions about it. They say that when it is going to rain, they feel the noise of enormous, rocky boulders which roll towards the abyss, and when they want rain, it is enough for them to light the mountain with fire in order to have rain in abundance. These peasants do not care a bit about the commentaries of scientists regarding these matters. As Goethe has stated, every theory is gray and only the tree of the golden fruits of life is green. These peasants narrate that the summit of this mountain is accessible through some high steps of rock, which were carved by very ancient hands. One of these peasants was telling the author of this current book how he was stopped by a rain of rocks thrown by invisible hands when drawing near to these millenary high steps. He was close to perishing under the rolling weight of a gigantic boulder, which almost squashed him. Another peasant explored the base of the mountain while following the course of the broad and profound waters of the river. He happened upon enormous boulders of granite, which were bathed by the boisterous waters of the river, and then he found a gigantic temple inlaid within the living rock. This peasant tried to enter into the temple through the central door, since this gigantic temple had three doors, but he found himself surrounded by many serpent skins. Consequently, he flew away terrified. Later on, he returned to this place in order to see the temple, yet he did not find anything. That temple disappeared, as if it had been swallowed by those gigantic rocks. I, Samael Aun Weor, visited that temple in my astral body. The masters who dwell there welcomed me with their open arms. They lead me towards the interior of this monastery, which was illuminated by a seven-armed candelabra of massive gold, similar to the seven-armed candelabra of gold from the Temple of Solomon. I then received from them secret teachings. Theosophists believe that the masters are only in Tibet, and some of them would like to travel there in order to follow the Chelahud Fellowship. Yet, the monasteries of the White Lodge are sprouting all over the world. In the East, the Mahatmas are called Nagas, that is to say, serpents. This is why all of the guardians from the sacred crypts of the Temple of Mysteries have the figure of gigantic serpents, who only allow initiates to enter. The poison of a snake kills, yet, we can arrive to the high initiation with this poison, which is a precious arcanum. Listen to me, initiate reader, the hiss of the snake is the base of four fei. This statement is not for all readers, therefore, he that hath an ear, let him hear. The inhabitants of Tierra Liana, state of Zulia, Venezuela, make the serpents flee when they pronounce the following mantras. The vowels of these mantras are I, A, O, which are combined with the tremendous letter S. Here is wisdom. Let him that hath understanding, understand. Even though grammarians do not say so, the letter S is also a vowel. We have to pronounce the three vowels I, A, O, together with the priestess wife, while connected during sexual magic, because I, A, O, is the name of our serpent. To clarify this chapter, we will say, the polar epoch corresponds to the mercurial intelligence of the serpent of the Logos, the heat. The Hyperborean epoch corresponds to the serpent's solar atoms, the fire. The Lemurian epoch corresponds to the lunar atoms of the serpent of the Logos, the humidity. Our Kundalini is also formed from solar and lunar atoms and from a synthesis of omniscient atoms. Hence, the wisdom of seven eternities is integrated within the serpent. The woman is the vestal of the temple, thus, the fire of the temple is lit by the vestal. In ancient times, the fire was guarded and lit by the vestals. This symbolizes that only the woman has the unique capability of lighting her husband's fire of kundalini, which is the fire from our body or our temple. The temple of the very high living God is our body, and the fire of this temple is the kundalini, which our vestal spouse lights by means of the same sexual contact, or sexual magic, as taught in the book The Perfect Matrimony, or The Door Entering into Initiation, and as well within this current book. In this present time, the Roman Catholic Church has totally lost the tradition. That is why we see that in this Roman Church the fire of the temple is lit by acolyte boys, an action that is not only an absurdity, but moreover, a very grave sacrilege and an insult to life itself. Continuing on, we say that the former cosmic periods actually exist within our seminal atoms, and it is merely enough to learn the technique of interior meditation in order to enter into their dominions. The entering door to those powerful atomic civilizations is in our sexual organs. The pralayas and manvantaras are happening within an always eternal instant. Past and future are joined within an eternal now. Time does not exist. It is the mind of the human being that is in charge of dividing the eternal now in six past and future. The powerful Saturnine, solar, and lunar civilizations still exist in the depth of our seminal system. We can enter into their dominions by means of interior meditation. The transition of the consciousness from one state into another is what we erroneously call time, but these states of consciousness are in a successive enchainment within an eternal now. Therefore, the human being must learn to always live in the present, liberating himself from all type of pompous theosophy, religious sectarianism, country and flag fanaticism, religions, intellectualism, yearning for accumulation and general attachments. All of these hedonistic parrot cages are nothing else but a den of business and tyranny. We gain nothing from their gibberish, because they only achieve to fill us with prejudices and absurd fanaticism. The whole wisdom of all ages is within ourselves. Past and future are joined within an eternal now. All of the cosmic wisdom is within ourselves. The solar atoms initiate us into the wisdom of the fire. The lunar atoms initiate us into the very ancient Neptunian Amantine wisdom. The sacred fire awakens and we convert ourselves into gods when these solar and lunar atoms make contact. During full moon nights, the lunar atoms make contact with the silver shield of our mental body. At that time we can receive the teachings of the lunar wisdom by means of meditation. 7 lunar ethereal currents exist. The civilization of our ancient Earth Moon intensely lives within them. The solar and lunar civilizations live within our interior worlds and we can visit those civilizations by means of profound interior meditation. The solar and lunar civilizations, which intensely palpitate within our own internal worlds, initiate us into their profound truths. They take us to the great illumination by means of the awakening of the sacred fire of Kundalini through sexual magic. Our 7 chakras are 7 internal churches, and each one of these 7 churches contains the wisdom of a cosmic period. When we have opened the 7 seals from the 7 churches of the human book with the sword of the Kundalini, then the 7 churches deliver to us the whole cosmic wisdom of the 7 cosmic periods of the Mahamanvantara. This is how we become omniscient. The book of the Apocalypse, Revelation, says the following, "And when he had opened the 7th seal, there were silence in heaven about the space of half an hour. And I saw the 7 angels, which stood before God, and to them were given 7 trumpets. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer, and there was given unto him much incense, that he should offer it with the prayers of all saints upon the golden altar which was before the throne. And the smoke of the incense which came with the prayers of the saints ascended up before God out of the angel's hand." Revelation 8:1-4. Here, the Apocalypse refers to the book sealed with 7 seals, which is within our organism with its 7 churches. It clearly tells us that only the Lamb can open its 7 seals with the sword of the Kundalini. The Lamb is our interior angel, that is to say, our intimate. When the 7th seal is opened, the seal that is related with the Church of Laodicea, situated on the head, then the Lamb teaches that the 7 angels of the 7 trumpets are the same 7 angels of the 7 churches. The angel with the golden censer is our intimate, who triumphantly enters into the white hierarchy along with his diamond soul. He becomes another perfect one among the community of the elected ones. And the angel took the censer, and filled it with the fire of the altar, and cast it into the earth, and there were voices, and thundering, and lightnings, and an earthquake. Revelation 8:5. Here the Apocalypse tells us that when we have opened the 7th seal with the sword of the Kundalini, then the 7 churches open their doors for us and teach us the wisdom of the 7 great terrestrial periods, which correspond to the 7 great cosmic periods. The 8th chapter of the Apocalypse continues referring to the 7 angels, stating that when they consecutively sound their respective trumpets, the great cosmic events are successively occurring. These 7 angels are the angels of our 7 planets, who direct the seven chakras of our organism and also the seven terrestrial epochs. Therefore, the seven terrestrial epochs are directed by seven cosmic hierarchies, and the whole wisdom of all of these seven epochs is within our seven chakras. Our terrestrial period has seven epochs. And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head, and his face was as it were the sun, and his feet as pillars of fire, and he had in his hand a little book open, and he set his right foot upon the sea, and his left foot on the earth, and cried with a loud voice, as when a lion roareth, and when he had cried, seven thunders uttered their voices. Revelation 10:1-3, this angel is the hierarch of the seventh epoch. The rainbow symbolizes our present terrestrial period, which started with the rainbow, Genesis 9:12-13. This happened in Atlantis, because Lemuria was a recapitulation of the lunar period. The little book that the angel had in his hand is the book of human evolution. It is the book sealed with seven seals, yet it is the book already without seals. It is the human organism of the one who has already opened the seven seals. It is the body of the master. It is the cosmic wisdom of the one who has already reached deep self-realization and cried with a loud voice, as when a lion roareth. And when he had cried, seven thunders uttered their voices. Revelation 10:3. Here the Apocalypse tells us about the lost word, about the sacred syllable that the seven thunders of the seven chakras uttered with their voices. These voices are the seven notes of the lost word. The sacred syllable opens the seven chakras, and so each chakra has its own keynote. He that has an ear, let him hear. Here is wisdom. Let him that has understanding understand. The lost word shall be found in the seventh epoch. And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. Revelation 10:4. Each note of the lost word encloses tremendous unutterable secrets. Each note of the lost word is the key note of a terrestrial epoch. Thus, the key note of the Egyptian civilization is one note, and another is the key note of the Hindustani civilization, and so forth successively. In the days of the seventh epoch, the lost word shall totally fulfill the mystery of the kingdom of God. The Swedish mystic philosopher Swedenborg said the following when referring to the lost word: search for it in China, and maybe you will find it in the Great Tartar. The black magicians of Sodom use the mantra Mathra, they pronounce it Masra, for their demonic goals. They assert to their disciples that Mathra is the lost word, yet, in reality, this word is the name of a temple of black magic of ancient Atlantis, and at the same time a mantra for black magic. Thus, Mathra is not the lost word. In India, the Arahats were persecuted because they were possessing the sacred syllable. In China, the disciples of Tathagata possess the lost word. In Tibet, the lost word is very well protected, for here is where the Mahachon abides. The lost word shall be found in the seventh epoch. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he had declared to his servants the prophets. And swear by him that liveth for ever and ever, who created heaven, and the things that therein are, and the earth, and the things that therein are, and the sea, and the things that are therein, that there should be time no longer. Revelation 10:7-6. The initiate who is already united with his intimate is liberated from the illusion of time, because past and future are joined within an eternal now. Each one of the seven terrestrial epochs finishes with a great cataclysm, which is symbolically described in the Apocalypse in the following way: and the first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood, and they were cast upon earth, and the third part of the trees was burnt up, and all green grass was burnt up. Revelation 8:7, this was the first cataclysm of the first epoch. And the second angel sounded, and as it were a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea. And the third part of the sea became blood, and the third part of the creatures which were in the sea, and had life, died, and the third part of the ships were destroyed. Revelation 8:8-9, this was the end of the second epoch. And the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp, and it fell upon the third part of the rivers, and upon the fountains of waters. And the name of the star is called Wormwood, and the third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died of the waters, because they were made bitter. Revelation 8:10-11, this was the end of the third epoch. And the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. Revelation 8:12, this was the end of the fourth epoch. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. Revelation 9:1-2, the abyss is the avici, which is a submerged plane of consciousness, where only the weeping and gnashing of teeth are heard. Here is where the souls who have horns on their forehead enter. The horns on the forehead are the mark of the beast. In this present times, the abyss is open and millions of demonic souls are entering into the abyss. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. Revelation 9:11, we are in the epoch of wars because they are necessary, since war produces millions of dead. Thus, the souls who have horns on their forehead enter into the abyss. Any clairvoyant can see the demonic souls. And the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God, saying to the sixth angel, which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour, and a day, and a month, and a year, for to slay the third part of men. Revelation 9:13-15, this will be the sixth epoch. In that epoch the human demons will be taken into the abyss again, after a very good opportunity for progress has been given to them. And the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices in heaven, saying, the kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our Lord, and of his Christ, and he shall reign for ever and ever. Revelation 11:15, in those future times, the earth will be more ethereal and only the human beings who have reached the angelical state will live in it, because the millions of demonic souls will definitively go into the abyss, where they will be disintegrated throughout the ages. This is the second death. Chapter 11 Limeria and Jehovah Elohim planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Genesis 2:8, there has been much discussion regarding the topic of the terrestrial paradise. Max Haendel sustained that the terrestrial paradise is the astral light, yet he did not inquire into what the word terrestrial signifies. Really, this paradise existed and was the continent of Lemuria, which was situated in the Pacific Ocean. It was the first dry land that existed in the world. The temperature during that time was extremely warm. But there went up a mist from the earth, and watered the whole face of the ground. Genesis 2:6. The very intense heat together with the water mist was creating a foggy atmosphere. Consequently, human beings were breathing through gills like fish. So, Elohim created man in his own image, in the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. Genesis 1:27. The human beings of the polar epoch, the Hyperborean epoch and even in the beginning of the Lemurian epoch were hermaphrodites. They reproduced themselves as hermaphrodite microbes reproduce themselves. In the earliest times of Lemuria, there was almost no differentiation between the human species and the animal species. Yet, after 150,000 years of evolution, the Lemurians reached a very grand degree of civilization, which we, the Aryans, are still very far from reaching. It was the age of gold, it was the age of the Titans. It was the delectable time of Arcadia, a time in which what is mine and what is yours did not exist, because everything belonged to everybody. It was the time in which the rivers were pouring forth milk and honey. The imagination of the human being was an ineffable mirror in which the panorama of the starry heavens of Urania was solemnly reflected. The human being knew that his life was the life of the gods. The one who knew how to play the lyre was shaking the divine fields with his delectable melodies. The artist who was handling the brush inspired himself with the eternal wisdom. He gave to his delicate sculptures the tremendous majesty of God. Oh, the epoch of the Titans! It was an epoch in which the rivers were pouring forth milk and honey. The Lemurians were of a high stature and they had a broad forehead. They wore symbolic tunics, which were white in the front and black in the back. They had flying ships and boats propelled by atomic energy. The lighting system used in the Lemurian structures was made from nuclear energy. They reached a very high degree of culture. Such were the times of Arcadia. The human being knew how to listen to the voice of the gods through the seven vowels of nature. The seven vowels I, E, O, U, A, M, S were resounding in the Lemurian bodies with all of the ineffable music of the accentuated rhythms of the fire. The Gnostic disciple must vocalize for 1 hour daily the vowels in the described written order. Each vowel must be prolonged as follows, emptying the lungs with each intonation. Thuri aini 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 aith e u u a a a o ya m m m m m m m m m m m s s s s s s s s s s s s s s s s s s s. The letter I makes the pituitary and the pineal glands to vibrate, thus the human being becomes clairvoyant. The letter E makes the thyroid gland to vibrate, thus the human being becomes clairaudient. The letter O makes the chakra of the heart to vibrate, thus the human being becomes intuitive. The letter U awakes the solar plexus, tip of the stomach, thus the human being awakes telepathy. The letter A makes the chakra of the lungs to vibrate, thus the human being acquires the power of remembering his past lives. The vowels M and S efficiently help in the development of all of the occult powers. Therefore, 1 hour of daily vocalization is more worthy than reading a million books of Oriental theosophy. The body of the Lemurians was a miraculous harp where the seven vowels of nature were sounding with the tremendous euphoria of the cosmos. When night was arriving, all of the human beings were falling asleep as innocent creatures within the cradle of Mother Nature. They were lulled with the very sweet and moving chant of the gods. Thus, when the dawn was rising, the sun was bringing diaphanous contentment and not tenebrous grief. Oh, the epoch of the Titans! Those were the times in which the rivers were pouring forth milk and honey. The matrimonies of Arcadia were Gnostic matrimonies. Then, the human beings were performing the sexual connubii under the commands of the Elohim, and as a sacrifice on the altar of matrimony in order to provide bodies to the souls who needed to reincarnate. Fornication was completely unknown and there was no pain in giving birth. Throughout many thousands of years, Lemuria was sinking within the boisterous waves of the Pacific Ocean. Meanwhile, the Atlantean continent was emerging from the bottom of the ocean. Chapter 12 The War in Heaven. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels, and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. and the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea! For the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. Revelation 12:7-9, 12. There have been two wars against the black magicians. First, the war in Arcadia. And the second, the one in the year 1950, a date in which the pit of the abyss was opened. The latter is the war related with the millennium. The third war will be the one related with the New Jerusalem. When the terrestrial period was initiated, the mental plane and even the most divine planes of consciousness were densely superpopulated by every type of white and black magician, who belonged to the Saturnine, solar and lunar periods. The millions of black magicians were constituting gigantic populations of evil, who were obstructing the action and life of the white magicians. Hence, they were already a grave inconvenience for the cosmic evolution within the superior worlds of consciousness. If life would have continued in that way, then the progression of aspirants toward the superior worlds would have been impossible. Therefore, the white fraternity gave the mission of casting out all of the black magicians from the superior planes of consciousness to Michael. He received the sword of justice, and tremendous powers were granted to him so that he could totally accomplish his mission. All of the organizations of the Black Lodge and all of the temples of that tenebrous fraternity were established in the superior planes of consciousness. Michael was able to perform this mission due to the fact that he belonged to the ray of power. So, Michael fought in tremendous combats, hand to hand with the terrible hierarchies of the Black Lodge. This is how the great dragon, the old serpent called the demon, Satan, or black magic with all of its legions of demons, was cast out from the superior planes of consciousness by Michael. Luzbel is a great hierarch of the Black Lodge. He wears a red cape and a tunic of the same color. His tail or kundartigwader is extremely long, and he carries at the end of it a coiled papyrus on which is written the science of evil. The tail of the demons is formed when the current of the kundalini is directed downwards, towards the infernos of the human being. Therefore, this tail is nothing else but the kundalini itself that has departed downwards from the coccyx. The horns of every black magician are certainly the mark of the beast. These horns belong to the guardian of the threshold, who becomes the superior eye of the black magician. Ahriman, a great black hierarch, wears a red turban and he is chief of enormous legions. Lucifer was the greatest black initiate from the lunar epoch. His legions are numerous. All of these millions of demons remained in the environment of our earth. They dedicated themselves to placing all of the human souls on the way of the black path. Beelzebub, with his legions, also established himself in our environment. He became very well known by all of the present human beings throughout time. In the Bible, Beelzebub is called the god of Ekron because a temple was built for him in Ekron, and he was worshipped there as a god. So, Beelzebub established his cavern and dedicated himself fully, as in the ancient periods, to misleading souls. The Bible refers to Beelzebub in Matthew, chapter 12, verses 24-27, as follows. But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, "This fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub the prince of the devils." And Jesus knew their thoughts, and said unto them, "Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation, and every city or house divided against itself shall not stand. And if Satan cast out Satan, he is divided against himself, how shall then his kingdom stand? And if I by Beelzebub cast out devils, by whom do your children cast them out? Therefore they shall be your judges." All of the black magicians established their temples, lodges, halls, cults, etc. on our earth, and they dedicated themselves to the developing of their plans in accordance with the supreme commands of Jav. Therefore, they are responsible for the failure of our present human evolution, since it is a terrible reality that this present human evolution has failed. Michael triumphed in the heavens, but our earth was filled with profound darkness. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth!